Mr. Segun Agbaje is the Managing Director of Guaranteed Trust Bank PLC. An alumnus of the Harvard Business School, he holds a Bachelor of Science and Master's in Business Administration from the University of San Francisco. With over 20 years of investment and international banking experience, he has earned a reputation as a truly accomplished and highly respected professional. Prior to joining GTB, he worked with Ernst & Young in the U.S. and subsequently joined GTB as a pioneer staff in 1991 and rose through the ranks to become executive director in January 2000 and deputy managing director in 2002. Mr. Agbaje was very instrumental in the move that made GTB the first Nigerian company and first bank in sub-Saharan Africa to be listed on the main market of the London Stock Exchange. Mr. Agbaje is an innovator and a disruptor. He pioneered Indani TV to capture the next generation of account holders. Now, many of the banks are following suit. He has pioneered many initiatives, including partnership with the arts, the concept of the SME Market Hub as an ecosystem for his depositors, and has also made banking very easy with the Star 737 mobile feature. In June 2011, Mr. Agbaje was appointed Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of Guaranteed Trust Bank. He serves on the boards of several other notable companies, including GTB Ghana, GTB Gambia, GTB UK, and also Director on the MasterCard Advisory Board for the Middle East and Africa. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, please stand up on your feet and let us welcome Mr. Segun Agbaje as he shares with us the secrets of success in 21st century Nigeria.
The good thing about videos is they make you seem better than you are, really. But the one thing I didn't miss is that I went to a university called the University of San Francisco, which is an average university, which tells you that, you know, for average people who work hard and are disciplined, the sky's the limit. I mean, MBA after was easy, but really as an average, I always say to people, I'm basically an average person who can outwork most people. And I say to my son, talent, there's a book which I love, which I gave him called Talent is Overrated. I really believe that talent is overrated. And that the people who succeed in life are people who are willing to work harder than everybody else. And that if you work harder than everybody else, you become smarter than everybody else. And then people say you're lucky. But then, you know, I'd rather make my own luck. And I found that the harder I work, the luckier I seem to get. So I think on that note, I just wanted to kind of lower your expectations and let you know that it's an average person who's speaking to you today. Normally, in life, I always say to people who are close to me, I never like to talk about the past, because as you can see, the past was not as good as my present and my future. I was in university, I had to work, I had to take the bus to school. So the past is never that interesting, and I like to believe that my present and my future will always be better than my past. However, today, I'm going to break that rule and start a bit from the past. And I'm going to try to talk about the macro of Nigeria and start at a time where there's so many young people. Maybe you won't know all of this, but there'll be people and very high overview starting in the 70s. In Nigeria in the 70s, I think we all hear about these great glory days. The exchange rate was about 75 kobo to the dollar. Everything was great. We're in an oil boom time. We had a very young head of state who said at the time that the problem of Nigeria was how to spend the money we were earning, and that, you know, life was just going to always be an upward trajectory. As we got into the 80s, this started to change a bit. And I remember then going to school and things had started changing. It was the days of import license. Effort scarcity started, and you know, by about 1984, 1985, the rest of the world was saying to Nigeria, you need to devalue, you need to embrace SAP in order for your exchange rate to float and for you to have availability. Anyway, in the later 1985s, we did devalue. We went to 4 Naira, I think, which everybody thought was a disaster. went to about 7 naira, and then a funny thing started to happen. We deregulated the banking industry. Before then, we had the old banks, First Bank, Union Bank, I think UBA and Afribank. And then all of a sudden we had, I think in the late 80s to 90, going into 1990, we had about 160 banks and finance houses, and there was just chaos and mayhem everywhere. But guess what? The country had started to move forward. In 1990, which is when I was brave enough to come back to Nigeria, I remember coming back with my hard-earned dollars and changing them on Karimokoto money line. The rate at the time, end of 1990, was 8 naira to the dollar. And we continued life. We had all these banks. We had interest rates of about 42%. We had the exchange rate at about 8, and then it moved to 22. And one day we were watching TV and Sani Abacha move the exchange rate from 22 naira to 80 naira to 1 overnight. And at the time, interest rates were also at about 42%. So if you think today is bad, I mean, that was mayhem. And then we continued, and we kind of approached 100 naira. And then we had a great thing happen in the banking industry in 2004, which was consolidation, which was done by Soludo. And all of a sudden, we went from about 120 banks. There had been bank failures. There had been finance house failures. And we went from about 100 and something banks to 25 banks, which hopefully were better capitalized. And we were cruising along nicely, as we do as a country, and interest rates were coming down. And then boom, subprime and the financial crisis happened in 2008, 2009. And we devalued to 150 for those who like to follow exchange rates. And then I'm going to stop in 2015 now, where we went to 200. All sounds like a pretty gloomy picture, doesn't it? There are two things that will hit you in listening to this. Sounds very familiar. We're kind of here and we've been here before. Sounds gloomy, sounds like gloom and doom. Unfortunately, I'm not one of those people who sees gloom and doom. I believe that Nigeria remains the greatest place on earth to do business. I believe that Africa as a continent is the greatest place to do business. And hopefully by the time we finish, I'll start to show you some of this. There are very few countries in the world that have a population of, you know us, we're always arguing about data, but I think we say we're about 170 million people, of which 50% are below the ages of like 28, which means you have a very youthful, easy population, easy first movers. You have a great dynamic population. You're not dealing with people who you're going to have to pay pensions. You have a very productive population. The second and most important thing about, if you're not as smart as, you know, most people are very smart. I'm not very smart, so I always say something. There are very few things in life that have not been done before, and that people have not invested millions in correcting. So if you're one of those people, that's the beauty of about being in Nigeria and Africa. Everything is new. Very little has been done. Working in Nigeria is like a painter who has a huge blank canvas, and you can paint anything. You can paint your dreams. You can pick on what other people have done. You can leverage the mistakes they've made. And really, this is one of the few places left in the world where you can do that. In developed economies, everything has been done. Everything has been tried. The margins are thin. Where else in the world? Okay, I'm a bank. I mean, I make return. When I go abroad and I talk to people and I tell them that my return on equity is 30%, they think I'm from Mars and that I operate in another world. You're talking about people whose return on equity is about 5%. When in the world can people make 50% margins? Who has 170 million people to sell things to? When we went to East Africa, we had to go to three countries to get 120 million. Tanzania, Kenya, and Uganda. In Nigeria, under one roof, you have scale that has never been seen before. So I believe, one of the products of being born in a great country and in a great continent. I'm now going to move you forward a little bit and a bit slowly to 2016. Which everybody, when I read the headlines, I laugh. Again, it's all doom and gloom, But I say to people, we've been here before. What is so new about this? Today, if you look at the macros in 2016, they say we have two exchange rates, the official at 200 and the parallel market at 323. Those who were around under Abacha, we had 22, we had 80. There's nothing new. We've been here before. Interest rates today, depending on where you borrow, at about 12% to 22%. I just told you that people did business at 42%. They say GDP growth for the end of fourth quarter was 2.1%. Guess what? We've had 2.1% GDP growth. Inflation is 11.4%. We've also had inflation at 11.4%, and we've had inflation at even higher than that. And if you look at your own individual lives, and I look at my own life, when the rate was 80 to 1, I was driving a worse car than I drive today. I was living in a worse neighborhood than I live in today. It means that the exchange rate is not a deterrent to success. The exchange rate is not a deterrent to doing great things. You only have to introspect yourselves. Most of you were in college when the rate was 22 to 1, you didn't have cars. Even at 150, a lot of you didn't have cars. At 200, you bought cars. And let me tell you something, at 300, at 400, you will build successful businesses and you will buy cars. Every devaluation brings its own opportunities. There is something nobody talks about. When they talk about macros and give you macros, they never tell you the growth that also comes with devaluation. Everybody reprices goods. Everybody is able to pay more. The turnover in the country increases, and people start to see and make a little bit more money, and people get successful. Let me pause at this point and tell you that I am not telling you that this thing is easy. I started by saying to you, you've got to be ready to outwork everybody. We have a program on Indani called African Dreams. My prayer is never to put someone there who's a government contractor and has made money the lazy way. I want people who have made money the old-fashioned way, who have earned it, because there's no other route to success. All monies that is made illicitly will eventually go the same way it came. Easy come, easy go. The only wealth that is sustainable is wealth that you work harder for, that you build, and God blesses. And God does not bless illicit wealth. So for me, I sit here in 2016 and I will take the questions. I'm sure maybe people are disappointed. I only see hope. I talk to investors all the time. I think we used to have 30-35% foreign investors, and all of them come to Nigeria and expect to see the world collapsing, and they come into my office. I'm only wearing this jacket, by the way, because you're all so well-dressed in this parish. I never wear a jacket. And so they walk into my office and see this boy in a shirt. Everything looks okay, doesn't look too stressed. And they say, what are you seeing that everybody's not seeing? And I tell them, I see opportunity, and nothing has changed. 5 years ago, I decided the Guaranty Trust Bank was going to build a retail bank. At the time, we had under 2 million customers. Today, we have 8.3 million customers. That is only possible in a country like this. I look at a country that has 120 million people who have mobile phones and barely has 24 million banking customers. We haven't even started to see problems. We haven't even started to see maturity. We are still at infancy. And so I always joke with them in the bank that the day we get to 20 million customers, I'll start to work from the Bahamas. Because guess what? The day we get to 20 million customers, that day we become very profitable. And I'm not only thinking of myself. When I say individuals, it's people like you. I've been in banking 26 years. There was a time we never gave loans to individuals. Today, anybody who has a salary job that you can trace their income can access 5-year credit. People tend to concentrate on the things that are not working and forget the things that are working. Today, we're giving loans to people 5 years. We're giving auto loans. We're giving mortgage loans. Please don't abuse them, by the way, because, you know, you might have a consumer credit problem. But the truth is, that is the beauty of Nigeria today. People say to me, are you running a retail bank? You guys are high-end wholesale corporate bank. I say, no, We have 8.3 customers. 10% of our loan book is retail, which means we have $130 billion that we have given to individuals, and that will continue to grow. So if I was an individual working in a corporate setup today, what I would be looking at is the fact that I can now leverage credit. I can do things I couldn't do when the rate was 1-to-1 or 22-to-1. It's a 200-to-1, and every generation has its own opportunities, and the macro brings it different opportunities. I also say to people who talk about the glory days of 22-to-1 and 1-to-1 that you must remember that not everybody was successful, even at those rates. And at 300 or 400, not everybody's going to be successful. The people, though, who were successful at 1-to-1, I bet you if you brought them to this generation, they'll be successful at 400-to-1. The ingredients of success remain the same, just the way values remain the same. Discipline, hard work, integrity, those are things that are timeless. It doesn't matter whether what the rate is or what the macros say, there are opportunities there. There's somewhere, again, you know, I always say I basically, banking is one of the most unpopular jobs in the world, so I'm used to it. So normally when I get into taxis when I'm abroad, and you know, they like to chat, they say, what do you do? I say I'm a mechanic or I'm a chef or something. Seems a little more popular. Once you say you're a banker, you're looked at like a villain. Not to say that we haven't earned it. Sometimes we have earned the villain, but sometimes we really haven't. Sorry. Yeah, so sometimes we do earn the title of villain, but again, there are other things we're doing. So when I look at retail, I try to bring the opportunity to you. The other place that people seem to accuse banks of is SMEs. I agree. The banks have not done enough for SMEs, but guess what? The banks are growing. In Nigeria, anybody that ignores the SME sector ignores and mortgages their future. Because in Nigeria, every household has an SME. Whether it's your kids, I met two lovely young people today, they're SMEs. My wife is I don't know, maybe I'll call her a failed interior decorator. She's kind of given up and decided to be a homekeeper. But you know, in every household, they're SMEs. So again, this is something that in Guarantee Trust, we are beginning to concentrate on. You saw the Market Hub. The Market Hub is all about developing SMEs. There is another misconception or myth. People say banks don't like to lend to SMEs. It is not true. Banks are scared of SMEs because they tend not to pay their loans. And they don't pay their loans because they're not successful enough, not because they are bad people. Therefore, part of what we're doing with the Market Hub is to give you other platforms as SMEs to sell. Apart from physical locations, we'll give you online locations, which cost you nothing. Another thing this generation has that you have right now, irrespective of the exchange rate, is that you're able to do businesses at much lower cost than the generations before you. Social media, internet, your infrastructure to run an SME business today is so much lower than the generations before you. The biggest problem I'm having now in recruitment is that we can't seem to get young people to come and do white-collar jobs anymore. They want to be Bank EW, they want to be Debola, they want to be chefs. You know, nobody who's smart wants to work in a bank anymore, and I don't blame them. It's because of the ease of starting your own business. And truly, we are not running away from it. We're gonna help you. Today, the SMEs contribute 10.5% to our deposit base, but only 2% of our loan book. My dream and desire is to take that to about 10 to 15% in the next 2 to 3 years. On May 1st, May 2nd, we're gonna have a food fair. People say, are you running a bank? What are you doing? The whole idea of a food fair is, again, I think there's a food industry that is beginning to grow in Nigeria, and we're going to try to understand it. We're gonna try to support it, whether by loans, whether by putting you on the hub, whether by giving you visibility. We will support SMEs. Again, irrespective of what the exchange rate is, the SME sector in Nigeria is going to blow up. It's going to continue to grow. Competition is moving decent banks away from the high end to retail and the SME sector. Those opportunities are going to be there irrespective of what the rates are. In my introduction video, which by the way, I have to thank who did it. God, you made me look so much better than I really am and made me look like I accomplished more than I really have. I confront disruptive technologies for survival. I will never sit back and let other people take what I believe is my own business and my own market share. So if you think you're PayPal or Apple Pay, and I'm going to sit back, no, I will do *737, simple banking for every Nigerian. And for every dollar or naira you spend, I will spend as well, but I will not give up my market space. The Jumias and the Congas are very upset that we have the market hub. I always say they can never beat me. You know why they cannot beat me? The market hub is free. It is impossible to beat a business model that is free. So even in your own lives, when you're putting business models together, always remember that. The business model of today and the business model of the future is one that is built on a free model. Who wants to tell me what's one of the things you all use every day? If you hadn't met Pastor Tony and I asked, who is Pastor Tony, what would you do? It's free. Google costs you nothing. That's why Google is immensely successful. That is why Jumia and Conga are never going to be Guaranteed Trust Bank Market Hub, because it's free. Well, the MD of Conga might be here, but I've told his shareholders they'll never beat me until their model becomes free. For as long as I'm free, I will beat them. So I embrace disruptive technologies for that. I look at Nigeria and I marvel. I still believe that we haven't even started as a country. I believe as a bank, we haven't really started. I believe as businesses, we haven't started. I remember when Pastor Tony started this church. Look at it today. How many places in the world can you grow as quickly as you have as a church and have such a following? All these things are only possible in Nigeria. So really, Pastor Tony has told me he's going to prompt me, and when I was coming here, I thought I was coming to talk to about 20 people in a sitting room until I arrived, and I started to sweat when I understood what I was going to do. So I prayed to God for wisdom, and I prayed to God for strength and courage that I would defeat Pastor Tony today, even though he thought he would surprise me. I really want to leave some time for Q&A. But before I go, honestly, one thing I want you to know, I always say to people, I find it very difficult to talk about myself, but I can talk about Guaranteed Trust, and I can tell you that it's what dreams are made of. I used to talk to one of the founders of Guaranteed Trust, may his soul rest in peace, and I said to him, look at Microsoft. Everybody who started Microsoft is a millionaire. And he said, sharing the Guaranteed Trust Bank story and the original shareholders of Guaranteed Trust are wealthier and more successful than those who started Microsoft. And it's only in a country like this and a continent like this that such dreams happen. Thank you very much. Please sit down. I actually prefer standing. I'd rather stand for the Q&A. Yes, I'd rather stand. Sorry, I've told Pastor Tony I'd rather stand for the Q&A, if you all don't mind.
Thank you very much for that, Shogun. All right, the two interesting points that I picked out of what he has said thus far. The first is the fact that hard work beats smart any day. And the second is about the disruptive technology. I like that one because he really challenged me about giving off free things to get more market share. So, we're going to open it to the house now. If you have a question, could you just indicate by waving your hand or raising your hand? And we'll take them in batches of five.
I'm sure the church will surprise me and put the questions up or something.
All right. Good evening, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, my name is Paul Fo. I just wanted to ask, what are some of the books that you've read that have shaped, you know, your perception or your paradigm within that has helped you grow in Nigeria?
God, you know, I'll take them quickly. I read constantly. I always have a book. I mean, the last I mean, if you wanted a book today, I can't remember the author, but like I said to you, it's a book called Talent is Overrated. Please Google it, find it, and read it. It's a life-changing book, at least it was for me, and it was for my son. At the time, he wasn't working very hard. He was very intimidated by the Asian students until he realized that they were no smarter than him, and all he had to do was work just as hard as them, and it turned his life around. So that's one book I'll ask you to read. The book I'm reading today, you probably won't like. It's called The Big Short. You know, it's about people who make money they shouldn't have made. But I read all kinds of books. I read spiritual books. I read business books. I always try to make sure I have a book I'm reading.
Hello, good evening. My name is Tonya Ogunbi. My question is with regards to on lending to SMEs. You've spoken about Gates getting capital around 12 to 27%, which is probably why the SMEs are not able to repay their obligations. But the CBN has made capital available to banks that SMEs can access for between 1 to 5%, depending on, you know, how you structure it. But it is virtually impossible to access these funds from most banks. So what is your bank doing to ensure that SMEs are able to access this capital?
Well, thank you very much. Like I said, everybody believes the bank is the villain. Honestly, the banks put your application through to the CBN, and we wait to for the CBN for the money. I'm not sure, like most things in Nigeria, that thing was properly thought out, and that even for SMEs to scale and tick all the boxes to access the monies, I'm not even sure it's for the SMEs. I agree with you that interest rates are high in Nigeria, but I don't know why you focus on the high interest rates. And interest rates today are lower than they've been probably in my own 26 years, and that you can still do very good commercial business at today's interest rates. We do try to access SME funds for SMEs within our system, but just like you, we really haven't found it easy to get the CBN to disperse because most SMEs just can't tick all the boxes. So I would say that you build your business case not on CBN's money, and that you build your business case on commercial loans, and you will find that it is still workable. I think we all believe we have to have 5% interest rates for things to work, but you don't have to, because your margins in Nigeria, not everybody says, or abroad, they have single digit interest rates, but guess what? They have negative inflation. They have deposit rates of 0.5. They don't make the margins you make. So we can function at commercial interest rates and build businesses successfully, but we have to learn how to do it. Most SMEs, and I'm going to try to answer, sorry, forgive me if I generalize, most SMEs, once they start to make money, start to spend. If you look at how Indians run their businesses, you first have to build your capital so that even what you're borrowing from the bank starts to go down, and you start to put equity into your business. I really think as SMEs, you need to be very disciplined. Banks are happy to give you money, that's how we make money, but you have to be disciplined. Take money, pay back quickly, and invest in your businesses. And if you do that, you'll get rid of us a lot quicker, and you'll grow. But please don't build business cases on 5%, because those things are not sustainable. They're subsidies. And as we've seen in Nigeria, subsidies are not sustainable.
Thank you for that.
Good evening. This is not really a question. I'm just trying to add comedy to this. You talked about average college or university.
Yes, sir.
The average university in Nigeria is like University of Otukpo or something. Your San Francisco and the Harvard schools, I don't agree with you that they were average.
Well, you know, honestly, I promise you, the reason I say I'm average, I went to St. Gregory's College, and you know, I've never lied to my son. You know, I was never first, second, or third in class. But I say that life is not about first, second, and third. Life is about A's, B's, C's, and D's. So maybe I'll agree with you that I've always been an A, but I've never been at the top of the class. But I've worked very hard to make sure I've emerged at the top of the class.
I'm not seeing enough hands up. Now, you have the MD of the bank in front of you, and people are shy to ask the questions. Okay.
Towards
the
banking industry and supporting businesses or entrepreneurs who are focused in asset, long money-based infrastructure type businesses, where you need, you're working against global competition and competition that are coming from interest rates well below 5%, who are pricing at price points that even Nigerian industries or your consumers or your users are comparing global prices to, and your cost of financing is higher, which reduces your margin costs, which increases your operation costs, and you are outpriced and you can't compete.
Well, I hope I understand your question. First of all, you're competing. We always warned people before this devaluation who thought it was cheaper to borrow in dollars at 5%. Well, as you can see, it hasn't turned out to be cheaper because we've had a 35 to 40% devaluation, which means your cost of borrowing is about 35, 40%. And that if you're a local person who had borrowed at 18, 19, 20, you in the long run would have come out ahead. So, I mean, I'm not sure that you are at a disadvantage.
Ships or power generation equipment or infrastructure equipment, because they're not manufactured locally here. You have to buy this equipment internationally, bring them here to operate in this market. But if you're taking financing locally here at 5 to 7 years and you're competing, for example, with international companies from the North Sea or America that are on 20-year money at lower interest rates, the price points at which they're offering to the same people that you're trying to break into the market with, you're almost 30, 40% higher. And where everyone's looking at the bottom line and not necessarily local content, because quality for quality, you're matching each other, but price for price, you're way higher and more expensive than they are. How do we compete?
Look, I think what I said to you still holds, and we've started to see some of this. They seem to be ahead of you, but these multinationals who you're competing with, who have dollar loans, also want to repatriate all their profit, yes? And when it's time to repatriate, which you're not, you're in Naira, they're in dollars. So I mean, I can spend more time looking at it, but I've found that over the long term, what people think is a competitive advantage by borrowing in dollars, and I'm more than happy to sit and show you this, is that over, and that's why I took you through the history of what has happened in this country. People who have borrowed in a foreign currency over a 20 or 5 or 10 year period have lost. Because when we have devaluations, we don't have 3, 4, 5% devaluations. We have 30, 40, 50% devaluations. Yes, sir. Or who?
Hi, good evening. Sorry, my name is Ivyo Amorege. I have a live issue. Basically, I wanted to find out more details in regards to SMEs accessing loans, unsecured loans. Like, what are the criteria that need to be met? I am a salaried employee.
Okay, criteria for unsecured loans, yes?
Yes.
The first criteria for
unsecured.
First criteria for unsecured loans is that you must pay back, and we must know that you can pay back. Therefore, and seriously, that's what I alluded to when I spoke to you about the market hub. The only way you can take an unsecured loan is when the bank is comfortable that they can see your cash flows, they understand your cash flows, and they know you will pay back. So if, for example, your business is on my market hub and it's successful, and I know that you 10 naira comes in every month, come rain, come shine, your overheads and your operating expenses are 5 naira, you have 5 naira spare at the end of every month, it tells me that you're capable of borrowing whatever 5 naira will take. So the only way, I'm not going to sit here and lie to you. Nobody's just going to look at you and say, you're such a beautiful person, here's the money. No, they're going to make sure that they understand your cash flows and they can see them and that your cash flows can pay back. If not, ultimately, you're just going to be enemies. You're in the bank anyway.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you so much.
Hello, good evening, sir. Okay, my name is Kule Adewega. Just to commend what you are doing in the bank. I got my alert yesterday and it was quite good. My question is for you to shed more light on your plans for mortgage. And most importantly, please, can you refer me to someone I can talk to on Friday about my mortgage?
Sorry, I missed my plans for mortgage, but I missed the last one.
Yes, what GTB is doing for mortgage loans,
okay,
for young men, and also who you can refer me to in your bank that we can...
In the bank. Well, whoever you... Look, like I said, in retail today, we do have a product called GT Mortgage. And the good thing is all the criteria you need to meet are well articulated. So we're not, you're not even going to be swimming in the dark. And any branch you go into or whoever manages your account, or even if you call the call center, they will tell you the exact process for accessing a mortgage loan. And again, people keep talking about interest rates. I think in Nigeria, we have defeated this myth that you can't pay back a mortgage in double-digit interest rates. You can. And the banks have gone out as far as 15 years on mortgages. And at the current interest rates and 15-year mortgages, if you haven't over-leveraged yourself with the salary advances and salaried loans, you can pay back a mortgage quite easily.
You're saying average 15 years I can access?
Sorry?
You are saying average in 15 years I
can... Yeah, about 15 years we have found most people can pay mortgages even in double-digit interest rates.
All right, thank you, sir.
Hello, Mr. Gbaje, how are you?
Fine, thank you, sir.
Really inspirational. My name is Ade, and first of all, I just want to thank you, I just want to congratulate you on a phenomenal 2015 result. So well done. So today, if you look at the role of technology in banking, so if you look at the likes of maybe perhaps a PayPal, being as capitalized as maybe a Deutsche Bank, what do you see in the Nigerian context as the role of technology in the bank of the, you know, the bank of the future in the Nigerian context?
Well, look, really, there's no bank without technology anymore. If you look at all the gap bets we've made, most of the people who are competitors have 600-700 branches. We have about 234. Then we have the nice GT Express, which we do with Forte, which have been kind enough to partner with us. So in all, maybe we have 270. So we have bet on the fact that the mobile phone is what you're going to use, your laptop, your desktop, and that fintech is the way to go. Now, the thing I will say to you is that the Nigerian banking sector changed after the banking crisis, and today banks can't invest directly in fintech firms or anything other than banking businesses. But look, I don't think you have a problem because I know so many funds, foreign funds, even the IFC, everybody's looking to invest in fintech type technology. And the major complaint about Nigeria is that we don't even have enough scale in terms of the investment they want to put money into. So out in the world today, there's so much money that will finance technology. As banks, we are users of technology, and we're more than happy to continue to look at anything that is new that will help us serve our customers and take them out of these our overcrowded branches, which is the bet we have made.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening. My name is ABM Fidelix.
Hello.
Hi. Sorry. My name is ABM Fidelix. Thank you very much for that insightful speech. I have just about the simplest question. You made mention while you were talking about increasing like the consumer base and all. I just want to ask, why is there no GT branch at all on Lekki, like on Lekki Admiralty Road?
Admiralty.
At all.
No, okay, branch. I always have to be truthful. First, it's being built as we speak at the very beginning by the gate. See, we're cowards and we try to be careful. We've had that piece of land for 3 years, but the original planning approval was for a hospital. And so it's taken us 2.5 years to change the, whatever, the use of that property. We've now changed it from a hospital to a bank. And so I'm hoping that by the end of this year, or at least first quarter 2015, we'll be done. Right at the gate on the right-hand side as you come into Lekki.
Good evening, Mr. Agbaje. My name is Rolake. My question is in relation to the role of SMEs in economic growth. We've heard a lot of thesis around how SMEs drove economic growth and development in emerging markets like Asia, etc. And there seems to be quite a huge emphasis on SMEs being the real driver of growth in Africa, not just in Nigeria. But when I look at the scale for SMEs and the amount of the ripple effect they would really truly be able to generate in an economy like Nigeria, I do wonder. And one of the reasons I wonder, if you draw parallels over the last decade, a lot of the corporates, so the mid-market corporates in the oil and gas sector, you look at Owando, look at some of the manufacturing entities, the Dangotes of this world, how would you compare the impact of those companies on the real economy versus SMEs? Because the model that worked in Asia and emerging markets may not necessarily be translatable to the Nigerian context. So I was wondering whether really you really think SMEs are the future driver of economic growth, and whether you could, there's empirical evidence to support that thesis. Thank you.
Well, look, absolutely. I think SMEs are the only way. If it was the Dangotes and the MTNs of this world that were going to propel the Nigerian economy, they'd have done it already. If you take how many people those people employ, and you take how many SMEs there are, you will understand and see that the only way forward in a country like Nigeria is for you to have the SME sector develop. You know, that's why when they take things like income per head in Nigeria, it makes no sense, because people ignore how much the SMEs generate. I don't even think there is an iota of doubt in my mind that corporate Nigeria is not who's going to fix Nigeria. There's not even enough of corporate Nigeria. When I go into a lot of talks with young people, I always ask one question. Can you name me three great African institutions or companies? Three. African. I'm not even going to restrict you to Nigerian. Well, you see, I won't ask this audience, you're too smart, but people struggle. I start hearing things like Diageo, Nigerian breweries, and I have to keep going, dang, dang, because none of those companies are African. The closest we have today is MTN in Africa, and that tells you that it's not corporations that are going to fix Nigeria or fix Africa if you're in a continent where you can only name one really great institution or corporate, and that it's going to be an amalgamation of SMEs, and the force of the SMEs is so powerful that you will see that in about 3 years. The problem we've had with the SME sector in Nigeria is that the banks have not been ready to support it, because we as banks were making easier money in the corporate sector. The easy money's over. We all have to look for other ways to earn money, and one of those ways is to support the SME sector. And the other problem with the Nigerian financial sector is that it is controlled by banks. You don't have enough venture capital firms, so that the balance between equity and leverage is not properly done. And as we start to fix those things, you will start to see the power of the SMEs. I think the corporates, including us, are minuscule. We will become, by the way, one of the great African institutions, but we are still on the road there.
Good evening. My name is Taiwo. First, I must say that the passion and the optimism you've displayed is quite refreshing. And my question is, in a very volatile environment and dynamic environment, how do you as a business adapt faster and better than your competition? What are the systems and the mechanisms you've embedded in your own business to ensure that you're always ahead?
Okay, Toke said something earlier on to Pastor Tony. He said he likes workers' meetings. I meet with the people I work with regularly. We talk regularly. We don't fall in love with any position. If exchange rates are low today, we don't fall in love with that position. If interest rates are high today, we don't fall in love with that position. I look at life as being nimble and being able to navigate. And if as an organization, if you're two people, you talk constantly, you exchange ideas, you talk to other people, and you don't live in denial. Part of what I find in Nigeria is all the signs are saying red and people are praying for green. You know, red is red, green is green. That's how you adapt, really. If something's blinking a bright red, then you work with a bright red. And if it's saying green, you work with a green. Don't fall in love with status quo. Don't fall in love with the present position. Engage constantly and be ready to change very quickly. Keep your organizations very nimble, your structure very dynamic so that you adapt. And that's what we do. I mean, sometimes we change organization just by a conversation in a car. Sometimes a conversation on a plane. Sometimes we get a crazy call from a customer who has seen something we haven't seen, and we'll do a complete 360. So that's it, really.
Hello. Hello, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Agbaje.
Good evening.
My name is Dion Obolu.
Hello, sir.
My question is more investment related than, you know, which I believe you're in a position you're familiar with, really. Talking of Nigerian economy right now, everybody knows there's so much gloom and doom. Every infrastructure is almost next to non-available. Foreign investors are leaving Nigeria at a drove, you know, just looking for the exit to get out of the investment they have here. So my question to you is, what do you advise someone that has investment funds that wants to come to Nigeria? You know, what would you advise him? Do you think he should come right now to invest in Nigeria or buy, invest in a company or in the economy, seeing what we are all seeing about the negative all around us?
Well, first, I see no negative. I only see one challenge. Let me tell you, everything in Nigeria today is underpriced. Right now, as a bank, if you watch our posture, everybody seems to be running scared, but if you watch us, we are more aggressive than ever before. When everybody starts to run, that's when it's time for you to become aggressive. When everybody gets aggressive, it means every foolish person is in there. That's the time to withdraw. So this is really the time in Nigeria to be aggressive and bullish. The only thing we need to do in Nigeria now is figure out what the proper value of the Naira is. That's the only thing that would scare me as an investor.
Sorry, and that's where I have a concern with the exchange rate and the dual exchange rate we have.
We will fix that. I told you under Abacha we had 22 and we had 80. And one day we woke up and there was no more 22. So have no fears. The beauty of Nigeria is sometimes we're very stubborn. Sometimes it takes us a bit of time, but we will find the value of the exchange rate. This is not a situation or a condition that can continue. So if you were thinking of investing in Nigeria, please continue. And if you're talking to foreign investors, continue talking to them, because when it changes, things will move very quickly. And you know, for those who wait for everything to be in place, they've missed the arbitrage.
Sheng, there is a question here for you from someone posted on Twitter. It says, why are customers not appropriately informed when there's a change in bank operating systems? And what are we doing to improve it?
Well, I'd like to believe that the last time we changed our operating system, we gave plenty of notice. But I think that's a corporate affairs problem if they're not. But I would like to believe that for Guarantee Trust, the last time we upgraded our operating system, we did give plenty of notice, and we tried to do those things. I think we did the last one between the hours of like 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. So in fact, very few people noticed.
I've also heard you talk about SMEs and skill. Can you share some words of advice on how SMEs can scale up in this economy?
First, I think SMEs have to be bolder and they have to think bigger. One of the beauty of Nigeria, and I always say to people, if Nigeria has 170 million people, if you can do something the 1 million people will consume every year, if your dream is to be wealthy, you'll be very wealthy. And 1 million is a small number. So first thing is your business plan must have scale. You must think big. The second thing we have to do in Nigeria is, apart from debt, we have to find a way to give the SME some equity. And please, one other thing about Nigeria is businesses, people want to own everything 100%. There's no advantage to owning everything 100%. You would just stay small. That's the reality of it. If you want to grow, you've got to have partners, maybe investors, so that you have the right amount of equity. That means that we can put a bit more debt and you can think bigger. So I'd say the way to scale up is just to have, know that you're not going to grow by pure debt and that you have to have some equity and some debt. And your business plan, please, 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 should become bolder and more aggressive, because small businesses find it very difficult to pay back loans.
Hello, Mr. Segun Agbaje. Yes. Thank you for your time here. My name is Segun, and in 2011, when you had to be the MD of GT Bank, you were stepping into very big shoes, and the late Tayo, Lord bless his soul, had done so much and positioned GT to be one of the best banks that we all loved. So stepping into these shoes, what were the key things that you did to actually not only maintain what the management before you had started, but take the bank to the next level? Thanks.
Okay, can I speak truthfully? Okay, I'll try and speak truthfully. I'd been in the bank for so long. I'd worked under Fola Adeola, who was the first CEO, and I'd learned all the things he had done properly, and I knew all the things he had done badly. I'd also worked under Tayo. I'd seen all the things he had done properly, and I'd seen all the things he had done badly. So even though everybody bet against me in 2011, I knew I was the best man for that job. I also knew that I was prepared. I'd been deputy for 8 years. I'd worked under two outstanding CEOs. And so I'd taken the best of two of them and put it into one body. So I knew I was ready.
So my question is this. I have two questions, actually. The first one is about importation. So I come from a place where most people are importers, and they rely a lot on bringing things into the country and selling it. What advice would you have for people who have based their lives earning on importation, and now it seems very difficult?
Where's she? Who's speaking?
Oh, okay, sorry. Okay.
Then my second question is about...
Sorry, can you start again? I couldn't find you, so I missed it.
Okay, my first question is about importation.
Okay.
Right now, it seems very difficult to bring things into the country and to sell them because of the exchange rates. So I just want to know what your advice is to people who have based all their lives work on importation, and they're finding it difficult now to cope with the current realities of the economy. Then my second question is about investments for young people. So as a young person, you're earning money and you're trying to create a balance between expenditure and savings and investment for your future. What's your advice? Thank you.
Well, look, there are different sorts of importers. There are the big companies who we shouldn't feel too sorry for, because they should have all invested in local content. They should have done backward integration. And they do have the capacity, and most things can be produced in Nigeria. So I think for those people, as they start to see the reality, hopefully they'll invest in things that would help us reduce our import bill. The reality is we cannot afford to continue to import things at the rate which we are. The people I feel sorry for actually are the small businesses. But then again, they've never gotten the official money. So they've always traded outside of the official channel. So I'm not sure they're as affected. I think what has affected them the most is the devaluation, and that people's minds will come round to the fact that the currency has devalued. People will change their spending habits. So you have to look at what you're bringing in. You have to realize that there were things you could bring into the country 200 to 1 and sell that you won't be able to bring at 323, and find the right thing as an SME. But for the corporates, I think, one, they have to go back and start to look for import substitution, and then maybe after there's a devaluation, things will start to normalize. For a young person, very difficult to say, but I really think you've always got to continue to invest for the future and not consume everything you're making today, because you haven't even started to spend yet. It's when you start to have kids and they start to go to school, and those are your high expense years. So right now, all you're doing is really just enjoying yourself, and that it's better to build a habit of investing. But investing, don't ever invest. I'm a very simple person. Never invest in complicated things. You tend to lose your money. Don't invest in things you don't understand. Keep your money in a safe bank. When you have enough money, buy a house. You know, nothing too exotic. If you start to invest in derivatives, put your money in stocks of tried and tested companies. Don't believe it when someone comes and says, oh, this company's undervalued. It's not undervalued. That's the real value, because it's not going to do well. And if they say company's expensive, it's expensive because it's a good company. People say to me, Guaranty Trust is expensive, X Bank is cheap. I say, no, it's not. X Bank is expensive because it's not even going to do as well. So invest prudently in the stock market, land and cash in the bank. Really, quite simple. That's what I do.
So how about school fees? You talked about foreign exchange. How about school fees?
School fees. You know, this is very touchy because it touches the lives and the souls of people. God, how do I say this without getting stoned? First of all, the reality of where we are today is that the only subsidy left in education abroad is the tuition. Today, the ticket prices have changed, so you are not flying at 198 anymore. You cannot get accommodation for kids in university at 198 anymore. So where we are today is that to send a child abroad, we should start to think in terms of 330. Now, if your earnings are strong enough to support education abroad at 330, then you have no problem. But if your earnings are not strong enough to support education at those rates, you need to start to do a rethink. There's no point embarking on a journey that you cannot finish. It destroys the confidence and the psyche of the children. I don't think you should ever send children abroad and have to bring them back for financial reasons. I think you destroy them forever. And that we all have to be realistic that if children are going abroad, they're not going to be educated at 200 to 1. They're going to be educated at a rate much higher than that, and that we should plan very carefully for that.
How many of you agree with that? You agree that there's a difference between faith and presumption, right?
There are there'll be two more questions after this, but there's a Twitter question that is a follow-on to the one you've just answered.
Okay.
I'm over here, Shegun.
Okay.
Right. And the Twitter question was, why have Nigerian banks not thought about investing in professional education for the younger generation?
Well, the simple answer is we're not allowed to. We can only invest in businesses that are banking businesses. And if you work for us, we invest in your education. For anybody who works in Guaranty Trust, you go through a six-month training program. We pay you. And guess what? If you don't make the grade, we ask you to leave, even without bonding people. And throughout your career, we continue to invest and train you. So the only real professional investment we can do is for people who work for us. We're not really allowed to invest. However, having said that, we do invest in schools that are non-fee-paying schools. One of the things I did in Kano today was, as a school that we rebuilt in the north, and we're going to put ICT there. We're going to train the teachers. So I'm not sure you can call that professional, but we do invest in education, and we have a program called Adopt a School, and it's a big CSR thing for us. But it's mainly primary school, and this is the first secondary school we've just done in Kano.
Thank you for coming to speak with us today. My name is Daniel Komolafe, and my question is this. As a startup company, a tech startup company, without any significant cash flow, and with a product that is not proven, more or less, where do you advise us we go for funds to fund this sort of startup idea?
Well, you know, like I said, one of the things that will, and I hope maybe my own next life when I leave banking, I will have a venture capital firm. For a guy like you, really, what you need is venture capital, where someone's taking a risk on your business because it's not yet properly defined. But then you must remember that he's also going to take a portion of your business, or she's going to take a portion of your business. So I think in your position now, we should be looking for equity. The beauty of venture capital is at least there's an informal venture capital that goes on in Nigeria. So you should be focused on equity for now until your business leaves the startup phase. Even if you got debt at 5% today, you wouldn't be able to pay back because the business hasn't started. So what you need is equity where there's no pressure on your earnings and on your revenues.
Hello, Banky, have you got any question? I saw you. All right.
And, one more question.
Hold on a second. Mr. Carlo, you're on the executive board of Marketplace Alliance, and you meet a lot of younger people, and you also take on a lot of questions from them. Are there some thorny areas that a lot of the people who come to the Alliance are concerned about that you want to bring up tonight?
Mike.
Could you pass the mic to Mr. Carlo, please? Thank you.
Thank you. One great area, they've always talked about is how to access funds, you know, and we have tried to explain to them that funds is probably the last thing that you require. First is to even understand the business that you want to do and build skills for it, and that's why we're starting the business school to enable them build the requisite knowledge that they require so that they know what to do even when they find the funds. You know, you can put them to proper use. So it's about funding. That's the question that they keep asking. I have a business, how do I get money to run it? Seed capital, you know, I'm glad part of what you've talked about today will help the young ones here to understand that first is you need to understand what you want to do and work hard at it.
So do you think that has come out tonight? Do you think that has come out clearly tonight?
Yes,
as you said, a lot of young people who might not be asking these very intelligent questions tonight are here thinking, what I really need is money. Yeah. Things are getting harder. Things are getting difficult. I want to start a small business. Yeah. I want to do this or the other. Who can give me the money I need? So do you think we've addressed their heart's desires tonight?
I think we have, you know, but I would like a young person to also answer the question. Do you think your heart desire has been addressed?
Well, look,
or maybe Shagun should sort of talk
let
about that a little bit.
It.
See, a lot of people are asking questions tonight, a lot of intelligent questions, but we know, we talk to the people behind the scenes, we know where they are hurting, we know what their challenges are, and for many they're saying, we just need money.
Okay, I really appreciate this, and you know, I love working with young people, so I'm ready to give young people money, but you must be very careful with debt. You have to pay back debt. And so, just like the gentleman said, we have to first make sure that you even understand the difference between revenues and profit. You know, there's some basics we need to take you through. If not, half of you will run into trouble. I don't want you in your young age to be grilling from debt and never get over it. I think a bank like Guarantee Trust, we've made up our minds to go on this journey with you. We will not be able to give everybody money because there will be some people who just are not ready and don't qualify for debt at this stage. But for those who or can or will, we will work with you. SMEs have become our focus. Please build business plans that can pay back debt. The money's in the banks. The funny thing is, that's why I always laugh when I hear banks don't want to lend. Banks want to lend. That's how banks make money. But it's critical that banks get their monies back. And if you remember that and approach a bank with that attitude, you have a good chance of getting money back. Demonstrate to a bank how you're going to pay them back. It's not all about security like you think. It's cash flow that pays back loans, not security. So the money's in the banks. I believe that the banks have come round to embrace and go after the SMEs, and that over time, nothing's going to happen overnight either. I think you will start to see the impact of all this in about 2 years, just the way it happened to retail. But start to engage your banks more, please, because I think there's this belief that the banks don't want to lend, but at least in the case of Guarantee Trust, it's not true. We are willing to lend, but I say with some caution, we also need to get the money back because some of you are shareholders. I have to pay you dividends. And there are also depositors here. I have to preserve depositors' funds. So I have to make sure that whatever I give back comes back. And that's all.
So Shagun, you're saying many young people don't really want to work in banks and maybe work in organizations and institutions. They want to do business. Would you encourage that?
Well, I don't even think we have a choice anymore. I think the young people have decided that they don't want to be like me and spend 26 years doing anything. So yes, I encourage entrepreneurship, but please make sure it's an idea that can feed you. Don't live with your parents forever and be on pocket money forever. Pick businesses that are businesses, not hobbies, so that you'll be able to stand on your own 2 feet and support yourselves. But yes, I encourage, I think young people are today in a world where they're going to be business people. But please pick businesses and not hobbies.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mr.
Good evening.
Thank you so much. I've been so encouraged. My name is Stella Okene. My question is, considering what is happening in the oil and gas sector, the IOCs and the operators have invited the service companies and every other company that works with them for renegotiation, you know, and we've all gone giving huge discount. In short, some of them said 40% discount must be given. But my question is, are banks considering to review their interest rate downwards to suit this the situation on ground right now?
You know, it's a very sad thing. Someone said things are always changing in Nigeria. Up until the last MPC meeting, since about September, banks have been, at least we, have been dropping interest rates. And for hopefully anybody who's our customer, you'll see that. And that's because the signal was that there was an easing going on. The last MPC meeting moved the monetary policy rate up from 11 to 12%. It changed the signal. All of a sudden, when that happens, it means the government might start to crowd out the private sector. And it looks like the trajectory of interest rates have gone up, but maybe not too much, and we'll have to watch. But what I can tell you is that interest rates, at least on our side, and we did an exercise, had dropped by over 3% over the last 2 months. So hopefully that would help. The IOCs, I know, they've cut back on all service companies. They also have to survive. So we just all have to tighten up. You also have to cut your costs, cut your expenses, try to arrive at the same profitability, and when things pick up again, you can spend and have a little bit more of a party, really. It's time for belt tightening for most businesses.
Good evening, Mr. Agbaje.
Yes,
my
sir.
Name is Bayo Banjoko. I think the lady beat me to the question. I'm a borrowing customer of Guarantee Trust Bank, and I would like to attest to the fact of your willingness in supporting growing businesses. Some of us took loans 2 years ago when the market was robust. So she actually asked about you cutting interest rate. But my own question is this. Right now, the IOCs has called us in to cut rates. Our cash flow can't meet our repayments. So I'm not even looking at it from the angle of reducing the interest rate. I'm looking at it from the angle of restructuring our loan. So my question is this. I would like to know GTB's disposition towards restructuring loans and also lending to the midstream sector of the oil and gas industry, which is where I play. And then secondly, I also want to use this opportunity to thank you for what you have done for my business. As a borrowing customer of the bank, the times we came in and we came with our proposal, no banks will have touched us. But this is just to say that you believe in people. Like you always say, oh, you also want to make some Dangotes. So we that we have come up into this battle trying to be some Dangotes, and we have now found ourselves in the pot of steel. We're just appealing to you now that these big budding dollar loans we're carrying, we need you to help us sort it out. Thank you.
I think I did. I'll take you from the back. Let me take you from the most difficult part of what you think your question is. You know, I'm not going to, one day, Alhaji Dangote will tell you his own story himself, and he will tell you that there's no businessman who has not had ups and downs. And he should tell you a story about what happened to him when he first started building Obajara and the difficulties he faced. So you are not in an unusual or unfamiliar territory, even to people like that. Every successful person can tell you their downtimes in business. And the difference between people who end up successful and those who don't is that they overcame their challenges, not that there were none. So you are in very good company. Every successful man has been where you are, and your determination must be that you beat it. As to restructuring, we have absolutely no choice. We have to match your loan tenors to your cash flow. That is the only wise thing to do. We cannot sit and insist that you must pay us in 3 years if your cash flows pay out in five. So that's not a problem at all. In fact, that's easy. If those were the only loan problems we had, I wouldn't have lost all my hair. It's those who don't want to pay that give me this problem. So if all you want is just elongation of tenor, those are very easy things.
All right.
Okay, one last from
the state. You have a question there.
Yes, I have one question here, which is going to be the last one.
Okay,
I promise.
No problem.
All right. This says, my name is Shino Akonde. Banks generally design products for customers. Are there avenues where individuals can propose products and initiatives to banks, especially GTB?
Look, we have a retreat every year, and this thing came up, and someone said, let's create like an ideas hub, like a laboratory. And we have, but we're very careful about launching it. Because you know the problem with Nigeria is you're now going to get into problems about, oh, you made 10 naira from it, 5 is my own. And you could run into all kinds of problems, but we are thinking about it. We do have an ideas hub. We haven't launched it yet because we need to be sure that we're not going to get into any court cases from people when we launch these ideas. And that's kind of the gray area about it. But it's a brilliant idea, and we have thought about it.
Now, maybe from the stage, Rolayo, have you got a question? Or Mr. Kali or Pastor Benga? Microphone to them, please. Any comments before Mr. Agbaja takes a seat?
I think he addressed the main issue, because I work in a bank as well. And the first thing everyone asks is, why aren't banks lending? Why aren't you giving us money? But as you rightly said, people need to understand that it's not that banks don't want to give money, but we need to be sure that you can actually pay that money back. So I think he's really addressed the main question I was going to ask, because that's what people always come to us for.
Right, that's important.
Short of giving a vote of thanks, I think what I'd like to say is there are quite a number of SMEs that we have in the church, and would like to work with the organization. We have series of training programs that we have outlined sometimes in the future. We'd like for people in the organization to come back and just equip our people and just develop them.
It would actually be an honor to do that.
Yeah. From my own point, one of the challenges that most SMEs have is financial knowledge. All right? You've spoken about understanding the difference between revenue and profit. Most people don't know that. Some of them don't even also understand the dynamics of the economy. And so my question is, what's GTB doing to ensure that their customers understand the business and the economy and environment in which they run? Because that's a major challenge. And most of them are not disciplined enough to even do that on their own. So what's GTB doing to that?
Well, we have, if you go into our website, you will see that where we have SMEs, we have like basic tools, basic financial skills that you can download. We are also partnering with the IFC, and I think there's this French organization, I can't remember the name, which we are working on financial literacy for SMEs. You're absolutely correct. I can't think of one size fits all, but what we will do is we will work, the developmental and multilateral agencies are very big on this, they've done it before, so we have programs we're working on, and more I found that putting things on the website, online, for people to read and learn helps a lot. So that's kind of our first step, and then we'll have more organized forum, which is why I said it'd be an honor to come and work with the church and the SMEs and see if we can create the next Dangote, actually.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know whether you noticed this, but Mr. Sheikh Magbaje has been on his feet for an hour and a half.
That's not good enough. Come on, put your hands together. You may please be seated. Something tells me that Mr. Agbaje might just become a pastor someday, because how many of you agree with me? He's got the language, he's got the suave, he's got what it takes to hold a congregation together. And the way he spoke about GT Bank, you might think it was just a church. Come on, let's put our hands together. Honestly, there was a day, I think we were having lunch together, we were all sitting together, and I'd asked a question about Nigeria and the situation, and it was what he said in passing. He said something about Nigeria being the land of opportunities. And honestly, what struck me at that time was what we were preaching. We're talking about David at the time and Goliath situations, and how Goliath was the door of opportunity, was God knocking on David's destiny. So Goliath was the instrument that God used to bring David to a new season. And he was saying, no matter how hard things were, they're no worse than they were before. You know how, in a sense, people keep saying the former days were better. But the Bible says never say that the former days were better. And so I thought it would be a wonderful thing to have Mr. Agbaje speak in church. You know, we talk about vision, we talk about, you know, greatness and building businesses and building lives and building careers. But you know as well as I do that though God gave Moses a vision, Moses couldn't build without the Bezaliel and Aholiab dimension. So the men that God gave workmanship and skills and wisdom to build. And so in a season where we're driving a vision of building your destiny, flourishing, building your life, being successful, creating wealth, there needs to be that dimension where we acquire the skills, the know-how to build. We believe that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we can think or ask. But the truth is, he needs to work with something. And so your skills are very important in this hour. And that's why tonight is very important. And that's why we're introducing this Business Wednesday concept, where though it's church, we're speaking about the skills and the knowledge and the information you need to survive in today's Nigeria. And I think Mr. Agbaje has done an excellent work tonight. Come, let's put our hands together. Shagun, thank you very much. Thank you for your simplicity. Thank you for the way in which you've you know, delivered the message tonight. And I think everyone here is taking something away, will take something away with them. And I pray that God will breathe upon your businesses. God will breathe upon your ideas, and that God will bring other opportunities your way. And then God will cause men and women to come around you and, you know, provide that which you need so you can take the next step forward. Come on, let's put our hands together. So, Father, we thank you for tonight. Thank you for the things we've heard. Thank you for your son you've used tonight as a mouthpiece and as an oracle to convey wisdom and to bring information and bring illumination into things that are required to bring us into the next level of wealth creation. Lord, we give you praise and we give you honor. In Jesus' name we pray.